Hello everyone, this is Anusha. I think we'll wait for a couple of minutes for others to join before we start. But if you have any doubts or any questions, please start asking them while we chit-chat while others join. Yeah.
Good evening, ma'am. This is Ritu here.
Hi, Ritu.
I was just doing a random search on the topic, you know, and I came across many of your videos.
Yeah, so the videos have all been there from the beginning. And you can definitely look at the playlist, and I'll add these recordings to the playlist, and so you can be checking them out. And yes, I think
topics covered, but because this is the first time that IDOL has it as a semester one, semester two, semester system pattern, that we will have slight variations, because all the topics have just been distributed across two semesters. That's all that there is to it. So all that you need to do is work on that.
Fine.
But yes.
Thank you. Yes.
Welcome. Yeah. Thanks, Ritu. So, been searching and looking up the topics. That's good to know.
Yes, ma'am. Good evening. This is Sunita. Actually, we're very confused about, but when I watched your videos, they were very, very helpful. YouTube videos that are on the playlist.
They were done for UOM, for Mumbai University largely. So some of them are from the last year's thing. So there will be repetition. So those who have seen the videos, you can contribute to the discussions and be a co-teacher. Yeah.
But I believe that, you know, English or any language for that matter is such an evolving sphere. And even if we read about the clauses and whatever, you know, linguistic differences all the time, every time we come up across something new. So, you know, even going through the old ones and the new ones, I think it is going to give us a better view.
It's basically repetition. I mean, at the exam level, because these lectures are primarily conducted to enable you to prepare for the exams and not just delve deep into, the idea would be that we could try and deep dive into the matter. There will be a repetition because ultimately it's also a preparation for the exam. So yes to that. But if you have any other questions to ask and so on and so forth, please do feel free. And we will, try and solve the paper and take you through the questions and the suggestions and whatever else doubts that you have. Yeah. Yeah.
That's the concern, because the paper pattern usually what we saw in your videos is different, and now it's an MCQ. So that's a big question for us, how the questions would be asked for this paper especially. A little confusion about that.
Sure. So we will start with that in a sense. And for every topic that I will do, I will also give a list of what are the kinds of questions that you can get asked in the paper, because even when I was doing it at that time as lectures, I don't think we specifically spent much time on how the questions can be asked in an MCQ format to a large extent. So yes, we will definitely do that. What we can do is I won't wait any longer for participants to join. There are 25 alone, but this can also get recorded and people can join in and listen to the earlier sessions. So I'm going to share my screen. I'm also going to, on the Telegram group, if you're all part of it, share the link to the folder, the drive. It is a view access for all. I've made that happen. And the blog, and there are some resources. I mean, there are a lot of resources. Every resource is on the drive folder. And there are other PPTs that I also do with other colleges, in a sense. So you can look them up. They're all view access, so that's should be available to you. But you also have a book. I think, has everyone got the book that University of Mumbai provides for the semester one course? Have you had access to
No,
it?
Ma'am, we don't have it. Actually, we only have it as a PDF view.
PDF, abhi COVID time, PDF ke dauran hi, like when I'm saying the book, it is the PDF that I mean, but you have an access to the...
Yes, ma'am, we have it.
Yes, ma'am.
All right. So primarily the paper, what do you understand? Why in English literature are we doing grammar? That's the first question. I always like asking that question. Why are we focused on phonology in the next semester and on clause analysis, etc. in this semester? Yes, Ritu, go ahead. Please ask a question. Please share your opinion.
Yeah, I believe that, it's a general understanding that language is basically a combination of grammar and sentences and words together. So mm-hmm. when we are speaking a language, okay, you might speak and somebody might understand, but to have it in a structured way. So then we are going to, we need to study about the grammar component of the language.
Okay, yes to that, to some extent. And I'm going to be shifting screens back and forth to just take from slides that I have earlier prepared, because this is a very tightly packed lecture. Generally for IDOL, for other courses, you do have, courses that will come in to your syllabus to some extent, where you will have enough time over a semester to prepare. Here, you're going to be looking at it from, just a very short duration aspect. So that's something that we will be trying to do and work on. To answer Ritu's and to take forward Ritu's question, let me ask you a question here. When I give a word like he was driving along the road, I don't know why it is. Yeah, so that's coming. There's a lag. Just let me know in case I'm not clear, right? So he was driving along the road. She was walking. It was pouring. Heavily. Now, as you read this, and there are these kinds of sentences, wo sunsaan raat mein chal rahi thi, wo gaadi mein aa raha tha. Can you tell me what is the kind of mood that gets created? What are you anticipating will happen? Are you anticipating anything that will happen?
Possibly there could be a romantic tack to it. Possibly the monsoon, we can get up pouring heavily, so means it's a rainy season, monsoon. Maybe she's all alone. So it's mm-hmm. kind of creating a narration of maybe suspense, that sort of
yes. thing. Suspense is the right word. It could be positive, it could be negative, but suspense is the right word. Can you think of anything in films and televisions where how do they create suspense? Like whenever they have, there is a cut and there is an interval, what is the sequence completed or is the sequence in motion? Like do they interrupt at the while something is going on and they interrupt and say abhi interval hai?
Yeah, it is in motion
in the midway,
right? So one of the things that you realize in these elements, and just to take forward Ritu's point, is that, she was slowly climbing down the stairs or anything. You can take up any suspense novel and you will find that they will use the present, they will use the continuous. They'll either use the past continuous or the present continuous. But they will actually use a lot of continuous tense and give you those actions. The lights were flickering, it was raining, he was driving down the road, the dogs were howling, the wind was blowing hard, and you were constantly using this thinking, abhi kuch ho raha, abhi kuch ho raha, abhi kuch ho raha, and then you're waiting in anticipation, and it may be anticlimactic, which is what happens in most Hindi serials, or it may be climactic, which is what happens in horror and suspense novels and drama. But that is the point that you're looking at, is why we are doing grammar. Because you understand now that for all suspense novels, there is a continuous aspect of grammar that is used in order to create that kind of suspense. No one sitting in their home is going to figure out, oh, continuous tense use kiya hai. They're not doing, no one is sitting there and figuring that out in terms of a continuous tense, right? These are questions that you will have to ask yourself in terms of suspense creation. You will have to figure out what are the tenses and how does that create a suspense? How is it that the tense is kind of, blowing, creating an impression for me as, creating that element of suspense, creating that element of figuring out when an action took place or how an action took place and so on and so forth. So you will have to deal with those elements and focus on it. So that's one of the reasons why we're doing linguistic and stylistic analysis of the text, is that we are trying to understand what role does grammar play in enabling you to create meaning, to construct meaning. So meaning making is the core of this text. It is not just ki, you know, konsa tense used kiya, but also about, so this tense got used. So what was the effect that happened on the audience? In international baccalaureate, I don't know if anyone of you is a teacher for those people, but they have students there are sitting and decoding what is the style element of using a font? What is the style element of using a particular color? What is the style element of using a particular tense? So 10th and 11th standard and 12th standard kids are doing this. So I'm sure you can do it as well. And it's also fun to learn and experiment and figure out, oh, is that has a use kiya? So now can I change it? Now, if I said the lights flickered, she walked down the stairs, does it create the same sense of suspense? So you also have to think about your own conversations with your friends, right? Like I have friends who will just come and randomly tell me, you know, so friend A comes and tells me, you know what, last night I was talking to friend B. And I'm like, so what happened? You know, because something should have happened. Or there are these people who will come in and say, my favorite example is this, and I quote it everywhere, but I have had this happen. But someone will come and randomly tell me, I was watching TV last night. And it gets to me because, you know, whatever you're doing, you look up and you're like, so something happened, right? Like you are informing me, I was watching TV last night. Main kal TV dekh rahi thi because kuch to hua hoga. Bijli khadki, the TV burst into flames, fan tum pe gira, kuch to hua hoga. No, I was watching TV last night. Doesn't it irritate you? That is what happens with, because why did you look up? Why, if someone had told you, I watched TV last night, you would not pay attention. But why do you pay attention when I was watching TV last night? It doesn't matter which language you're speaking in, by the way. This is a very clever technique and children use this all the time. They use a lot of ing forms and you always look at it. Like children coming down and saying, I was walking down the road today that thanks to crime patrol, we suddenly are like, kuch hua kya, kisi ne kuch bola kya in all of it. And they're like, no, I'm just informing you, I was walking down the road. And you're like, I walked down the road would have been a nicer sentence for you to tell me and not panic me into this much. That's effect. And that is what we are trying to analyze through this paper. The linguistic elements, the choice of vocabulary, what does it do to any other elements? So this was one aspect of how grammar can influence. We can also look at it from, you know, the choice of vocabulary. For instance, when I say he entered the room, you know, versus he barged into the room. Is there a difference?
Yes, ma'am, it is.
What is the difference?
Ma'am, entering could be a polite way of just entering the place, and barged in is where the person is either in a hurry or is angry or is just too loud for that particular space.
Correct. And those who want to chat can please chat. I'm good at, you know, reading the chat messages and talking. So you can also chat into the message, but you can also feel free to, you know, unmute yourself and talk. But yes, you're right. So barged into the room gives you the sense of violence, gives you the sense of power and authority or frustration and anger in a way that, you know, something that is exciting. So he could also have barged into the room because he was happy and he didn't wait, but he was definitely not a polite person. He had forgotten etiquette and manner. And he was definitely someone who was looking at it from those elements of, you know, maybe young, you can be forgiven. Maybe younger, maybe junior, and would get a shouting because the seniors may not like it. You already get a lot more sense and context building depending on anything else that you know about him and the situation in life to know whether it was acceptable or not acceptable. That does not occur when you use the word enter. It does not matter because enter can be actually done by anyone, whether it is a junior, a senior, young person, old person. It is not a matter of privilege or anything of that sort. He entered the room. That's fine. He entered the room is not as dramatic and does not give you as much of context and of meaning making and assumption and prediction about what will happen next as barged does. And that is one of the other elements that you're looking at in terms of linguistic and stylistic analysis. classes, which could be dealing with vocabulary choice, right? So those are simple elements that you would be focusing on. It could be about vocabulary. It can also be about how you present an idea, ornamentation of an idea. And if you've watched enough of music shows, you will understand that ornamentation basically means that you could have sung a straight note, but then you are going up and down the slide and going here and moving out here and using a lot of yarmulkes or whatever. I'm not getting into the technical terms, but you might be, you know, giving it a lot of flow. And so you don't sing a straight note and you don't sing ah, you sing ah, and that's where your ornamentation comes in. And that's the beauty of it. Shreya Ghoshal is excellent at doing this. So that ornamentation in text analysis will come from something like figures of speech, right? So let's look at one of the concepts that we have in terms of figures of speech. What is the difference between saying he was brave and he is as brave as a lion?
So and he was brave, it doesn't give us anything to compare it with. What up to what level strength he has. But when we are saying he's brave as a lion, as brave as a lion, lion is supposed to be, you know, in general terms, one of the strongest animals. Mm-hmm. So possibly here the writer is trying to depict how brave he was.
Okay. But he was brave could have also given you that context.
But then we don't have anything to compare it with, you know.
But think about a cognitive load, and this is...
Meenakshi,
you were saying something. Go ahead.
Yeah. This is also simile.
Yeah.
We're doing the comparison.
But my question is this. Okay. Now, yeah. I have something as he was, he was as fast as a horse or a cheetah.
If I could attempt this.
Yes. Go ahead.
If I look at the word lion, probably the lion signifies leadership, kingship, and I see a little of authority in the person having these kind of qualities. But when I just say he's brave, so he could be like, if being a lion was like on a scale of 10, numbered at 10, then being brave could be anything lower than 9, 8, 7 kind of a thing, you know? So that is probably...
Anal, that is fine. But think now, I'm going to take you all through another process. So in the second sentence that I've given you two animals. He's as fast as a horse. He's as fast as a cheetah. Both of these are very popular similes that are used. And I've also given you a metaphor. Not that he's as busy as a bee, but he's a busy bee. That's a metaphor because he's a busy bee. Now, my question is this. If a child is reading a metaphor, this is the metaphor. If the child is reading the metaphor, is the child going to have, say, a five-year-old child or a six-year-old child? How many concepts does the child have to know in order to be reading this metaphor versus another question? The child reads, he was brave, and the child reads, he was brave as a lion. How many concepts is the child having to process? A 5 or 6 year old child having to process in that simile. He's as brave as a lion.
He was brave would be a simple simpler way to understand for a child, a 5 year old child or a 6 year old child. The first sentence would be quite simpler for him to understand. There'd be no kind of comparison. There'd be no kind of much more thinking processes out here. But when we talk about he is as brave as a lion, he'd be wondering that we're still talking about a lion. No matter, he's as brave as a lion, but
it so could first be... the child has to identify what a lion is. The lion is not the tiger, not the cheetah, not anything else. It's not the dog and the cat. It is a lion. First, the child has to identify what a lion is. Second, the child has to identify he has only got the quality of the braveness of the lion. He doesn't have the other qualities of a lion, like a mane, like a, you know, like the roar, like the paws, you know. Sorry, someone was saying something. Shraddha, were you saying something?
I was just saying the same thing that you were putting.
Yeah. So the child has to understand so many concepts and constructs in that process of understanding the simile. Simile is a wonderful way of connecting two ideas, but it's also a very cognitively loaded process. And metaphor makes that process even more complicated because now the child has to figure out he is not a bee. he is like a bee. Now I have to add the like because the sentence did not give it to me. And I have to figure out that he is not a bee. He is like a bee. But he's not just like a bee in all concepts of a bee. He is not someone who can make honey or anything like that. He is a bee as in terms of the busyness of a bee. Now he has to figure out that A, the bee is a busy bird, busy insect. He has to now figure out why the bee is considered the busy insect and why can't an ant be considered a busy insect? You know, all these concepts and constructs that a child has to figure out is something that is loaded in terms of the figure of speech. And when we are doing this and we are teaching children, we are very conscious in, you know, when texts, when storybooks are written, editorial committees are very conscious of figuring out whether this language is okay for a 2 to 3 year old child, for a 3 to 5 year old child, for a 5 to 7 year old child, for a 6 to 8 year old child. That is because there is a cognitive load on the brain in terms of reading those sentences. And you have to understand whether that cognitive load is something that the child will be able to understand. There is a movement already here in terms of abstraction, because brave is a quality, not something that can be seen, felt, heard, which is what you will give generally for 2 to 3 year old children in storybooks, is things that can be seen, heard, felt. You know, they are something that can be actually, green is a color that you can see. So the pencil is green, the crayon is red, and those kinds of sentences, which are very repetitive in structures, but they're also very focused on concrete experiences. Brave is not a very concrete experience already. Now that child has to abstract. Now the child has to abstract then again about the fact that this is a comparison to a lion, but not every quality of the lion. So now I have to compare this person to a lion, but only to one quality of the lion. So I do both connections. You get the complexity of that cognitive load that the child has to undergo. And this is one aspect of the ornamentation that is looking at it. And this is what stylistic analysis is also about. Understanding whether the ideas are complexly presented, whether there is a use in that kind of presentation, whether it meets the purpose. For instance, in speeches, you would not want to use too many similes and metaphors which are not popular to the audience. You will want to think about the fact that we may say he's as fast as a horse, because in Indian context, you understand that a horse is fast. Wo ghode ki tarah bhagta hai. We understand that. But cheetah ki tarah bhagta hai is slightly more complicated for in certain sects. And definitely puma shoes do not understand. We don't understand that he's as fast as a puma, because while we wear puma shoes, we don't know what a puma is. And that's not going to help us at all. So that's something that you're going to look at in understanding concepts. It's also the fact that I can teach using this. You may not know qualities of a lion. You may not know qualities of a bee. But now that you have seen this metaphor, you suddenly associate, oh, he is busy. He is known as a busy bee. That means a bee is known for being busy. And you suddenly understand that learning as well is happening. So you can also use this to teach them newer concepts and constructs that come in. And this is also from the application of a teaching position, from an editorial position, from a writer's position. Understand how you could use ornamentation to make something sound more beautiful, of course, but also make it more or less complex to understand. That's also a point in why and how you can use it. So we are doing this for these reasons, to understand and explore from these reasons. That's why we are doing this paper. And I hope that the use of the paper was made clear. I spent some time doing that, irrespective of whether students have doubts on that or not, because I feel you will fall in love with the paper. And if you do, if that helps you, if this helps you like the paper, you will do better at the paper. So that's one aspect that I'm going to get into. I think I have given you an overview of what this can deal with. So the first question was, of course, why? Why are we doing the paper at all? Since no one has chatted, I'm just going to switch off the chat box. So why this paper? This is the reason, and this applies to both semester one and semester two. The second question that I have is, what is this paper about? So the next part of this aspect would be, what is this paper about? And the paper is about four questions primarily, four topics and things. And the first one is you have something that's called short notes, all right? You will be exposed to certain conceptual linguistic terminology and in terms of short notes that you have. A list of topics has been given to you. So I would recommend that you look them up. I'm not going to spend too much time doing them, but in the interim, just as I did right now with simile and metaphor, which by the way is one of the short note topics, we will cover them in during all the sessions in between. But I'm not going to spend exclusive time other than that last lecture that I have with you on Friday on spending too much time there, because you can read it up. And I think that should be fine enough to look up. Yeah, it is given in your notes and it is fairly detailed and very lengthy and well explained with examples. So you have short notes now, and then you have something that we call the clause and phrase analysis. Which we will do today. I start with this because this is generally considered by most the most irritating and the daunting aspect of it. So I will start with this today. And the third that you have is a linguistic and stylistic appreciation of the text that is given to you. And this also we will do in between, but a very simple way of how this can be asked in a multiple choice question is that you could be asked this in you could be asked this in as we did here. A sentence is given to you: he is as brave as a lion, and I'm just repeating that. And then identify the figure of speech in the sentence. That is the kind of question that you can get. This is one kind of an MCQ question that you can get, given the four choices, you know, simile, a metaphor, personification, right? And if I'm doing this as a choice, that would be those kinds of questions. So, and it would obviously be that you identify it as a simile and a metaphor. Personification and maybe hyperbole, right? And if you have this, you identify which one it is, and that is the kind of question you may get. You may also get other kinds of questions, which we will do as we are going forth and looking at it. In terms of clause and phrase analysis, I will be doing it today, so I won't get into it. But in terms of short notes, again, you can get questions on, you know, the use of a simile versus, again, these kinds of questions can also come in the short notes. Identify the figure of speech in the sentence, identify, this is the passage, which of these are, you know, cohesive devices, what is the use of foregrounding and parallelism, and give you four sentences. So a lot of it is actually commonsensical and reading and being able to answer. So it should not be that difficult to do. In terms of preparation. And student-centric learning is about making questions, and we will come to that after we finish doing question two and three. Then we come to student-centric learning, and then we come to short notes at the end. But as I said, short notes will be a running theme. Topics of the short notes will be a running theme through the entire two papers. So one element that I start with to deal with clauses, and I'm going to also figure out from here, one second. One of the things that I always like to start off with is asking you, what do you think is parts of speech in terms of what are the parts of speech that you know? And we've done this in Hindi, Marathi, in English, you know, noun, pronoun kind of thing. So can you tell me what are the different parts of speech that we have?
They are nouns, pronouns, verbs, adjectives, adverbs, conjunctions, interjections.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that is one more. Which
preposition. Preposition.
And yeah. Preposition, yes.
A dustbin of the English language.
One yes, more determiner part. We have.
The article.
Yes, we have determiners yes. And enumerators. Yes. So the reason I keep asking that kind of a question is that you will need to know the parts of speech in order to be able to, because you can be asked certain questions on the parts of speech. And you could be asked what these parts of speech really signify and what the functions of these will be like. I'm just going to quickly take a few from the earlier slides and push them in. And you can always have access to this. As I said, these will be available to you on the drive to view, at least, even if not, I mean, you can't edit, that's just asking for trouble, but you can definitely view it. So parts of speech, as long as you understand the different parts of speech, that is useful because that's what you need to know in order to do clause and phrase analysis to a large extent. So the part of speech here, as you said, is, a part of speech would be, the part of speech would be in terms of open classes and closed classes. And why do we need to know this? We need to know this as teachers and as editors to understand where we can play with words, right? So open classes, what do you think? Why do you think nouns, verbs, adjectives, and adverbs are classified as open classes? And why do you think a pronoun, a helping verb, like, may, would, should, etc., a conjunction, a preposition, an interjection, a determiner, and an enumerator. Enumerated numbers, so cardinal numbers or ordinal numbers, first, second, one, two, three, all of them. Determiner is anything that determines, like the, a, and, this, that, all of those. That modifies the noun, but it specifies whether it is some unknown quantity or some quantity. I'm going ulta, right? I'm doing enumerator, determiner first. Interjections, exclamation, we have studied this in school. It will express feelings. Even nouns sometimes can become a part of an interjection to say, God, why are you doing this? So God can be an interjection there, right? But generally those filling words like, words that don't have any meaning are empty words literally, but you infuse meaning in them with the intonation that you take on. Preposition, it basically prepositions the noun in terms of time and space. So I am in my house, right? So inside my house. So I am telling you where I'm located. I am at the doorstep because I can either move inside the house or I can move outside the house. So I'm at the doorstep. So it tells me that it is at the corner because you could turn in two directions, right? It is on the street, that it is on top of the street. It is on the table. So it actually tells you where it is in terms of position. It could also be in terms of time. I am, submit this by tomorrow. So well in time before tomorrow. That's what basically prepositions or prepositions really do. And so they always come close to a noun or a pronoun. Generally, that is the case. Yes, Ruthu.
Yeah, sorry, I just want to intervene here.
Yeah, sure.
Clarification. I was confused with the sentence yesterday. The farmer grows vegetable on his farm or in his farm? How would it justify?
So you don't generally say in the farm because it is not inside a particular space. It is on the ground. But the point in that is it will also depend that if it is in the farm's trenches, because the trenches then become an enclosed space in which you can be growing. So it will really depend on that kind of a situation. But otherwise, if you're just saying farm, then it would be on the farm. You have to think, that's why I said if one of the problems that I have with the way we teach grammar in school is that we don't make them imagine. If you could just make them draw in, inside, on, and then they understand what it means. Why do we say he's on time versus what do you mean when you say he's, reach in well in time? Why do we say, what is the difference between reaching on time and reaching well in time?
On time is basically at the time when he was expected to reach, and in time he reached before the time that was he was asked
for. So there is this flow in, and there is a kind of space and time within which you are able to. So there is a within concept there. And on is like on the dot. Why do we say at 3 o'clock? Why don't we say on 3 o'clock? Since we said that all is precision and all.
That is again the exact time, you know, at that yes. dot of time.
Understand, you are on
meet at 3 o'clock. No. So when I say I will meet you on, you know, on Friday, or I say that I will meet you on, you know, I reach on time. You're basically saying the precision, as you pointed out, Priyanka, on the dot in a sense. So it is on that spot in that sense. When we say at 3 o'clock, and this is why at 3 o'clock, it is giving you a leeway, just as at the corner, not on the corner as much. On the corner is not logically wrong. It is on the corner, but we generally use at the corner because it gives you a possibility of moving left and right. We don't say at the middle ever. It is always in the middle, or it is on the middle of the street, right? It is never at the middle of the street, but it is at the corner of the street, right? So that's a kind of thing that you will have to think of in terms of possibilities at the doorstep, because again, you can move left and right. So at 3 o'clock, because you could come before 3, 2:59, 2:58, or you could come a bit after 3, 3:01, 3:02, or something of that sort. You're giving that kind of a leeway there. And these are possibilities and methods that you can come in. I'm not going to teach you what preposition use is about. That you can go and read up Murphy's grammar and, you know, book, and has wonderful essential grammar in use as a wonderful book if you can, you know, find it. It gives you all these boxes and cartons and everything for children basically to learn from, but adults can learn from it nevertheless. But yes, that is preposition, right? Then there is conjunction that joins ideas, like I like tea and juice, you know, or I would like to have, you know, what is it? I like tea, but I hate coffee. So the but, the contrast and the linking and the addition. So they're linking ideas, and they could be linking those ideas at the word level, the phrase level, or they could be linking it at the sentence level. That is what compound sentences are made of, right? So I like tea, but I hate coffee. Two separate sentences joined by a simple conjunction that comes in. So those are reasons that you could be looking at in terms of conjunctions. And then you have helping verbs like may, would, can, should, or, you know, I did this or anything of that sort. And pronouns like me, mine, I, you, and so on and so forth. Now, my question to you is, these are the words, and then there are all the nouns, verbs, adjectives, and adverbs, which I hope I don't have to explain to you because we've done this so many times in school as well. All of these literally in school as well, in three languages, most of us, you know, naam, sarvanam, visheshan, kriya visheshan, okay, all of it, we have done this. So now, why the nouns are open classes and why do you think verbs and the rest are closed class? Why do you think that is the case?
I think both, all of them are actually noun, verb, adjective. So all of them have a certain set of words that have already been introduced to us. We know them as they are. But in terms of nouns, verbs, adjectives, and adverbs, there is a chance where you can create new terms. You can create new words. You can be creative in those aspects. But with the close, now you cannot come up with a pronoun. I cannot just come up and create a another pronoun that talks about the same class. So there is already something attributed to it, which is called by that itself.
Yes. And while there is a movement in the LGBT realm to introduce,
that's what I was trying to talk about.
Z that allows for a new class category to come in, still not accepted, but largely the ones in black are the closed classes, and they are not going to change much. They are static, they are fixed, and that's what Priyanka was saying, and that's absolutely right. Whereas with nouns, adjectives, adverbs, and all of it, you can keep making new words. Like Google was not even a word in 1990s and has now become the most used word. Zoom, let's Zoom, or I will IM you, or I will IG you, or whatever, you know, in a sense that, you know, FB is now Facebook for us, and Insta you this, or something of that sort. Right, WhatsApp me something, again, like not message me, nothing of that sort, it's WhatsApp me something, right? So all these words have become new lingos. You also can Google something, it can be a noun, which is, you know, on the Google search engine, It could be an adjective that this is just not Googleable. That's one of the words that actually came in and I was like, oh, that's a word. And, you know, I was Googling and this is so, you know, addictive in it's such an addictive activity. You can say that this is, you know, you're always on hooked onto Google. So there could be so many different words that come in with an adverb or an adjective or a verb. And yes, that's true. An adverb, of course, is something that describes another adverb. He ran fast. So it describes a verb. He ran how? He ran fast. And it answers the question when, where, how, why. That's what an adverb does. So how did he run? He ran fast. How fast did he run? He ran very fast. So the very is another adverb that is describing an adverb fast. Again, it may also describe an adjective. She is beautiful. Beautiful is an adjective because it's complementing the noun or it is describing the pronoun. And that's what an adjective does. It gives you more information about the noun or pronoun. It describes them or gives attributes to them. But then when that is described, you know, then you have a very or a rarely or something of that sort, then that's an adverb's job. The verb is something that tells you about the action. It may include the tense or it may not tell you the tense, but it definitely tells you what the action was. And we'll come to the tense aspect in just a while. And the noun is something that tells you who, whom, what, primarily as the actions. That's what it answers. Please do note the questions that were asked for an adverb or an adjective, because these are important to note when we are doing clauses to a large extent, right? So this is clear. The part of speech is clear. Why we move from the parts of speech, we move to another phase in terms of pronouns. One of the questions and one of the points that I would like to make is that you have pronouns of different types, and I'm not even listing all of them. I just listed a few. But you have an I, you, he, she, it, we, you, they, who. Now, this is a subject category. Then there is an object category, me, you, him, her, it, you, us, them, right? This is the object category. What is the difference between a subject pronoun and an object pronoun? What is the difference in subject and object?
Subject is basically when you're talking in the first person or the second person, but however, object is you're always talking about the third person. Is that it?
No.
Subject is who is doing the action and object on whom the action is being done, something like that?
Yeah. So I just changed the slide to this part because this is something we have done in school. Remember, again, this is all school grammar. I'm not doing new grammar. Object direct and object indirect. Every one of us were tortured with this from 7th standard onwards or 6th standard onwards, depending on your school board, but definitely were tortured through this till 10th, right? We chose to cheat, copy, maro tukka, whatever, but we did this.
Renan Martin, the Bible that time.
Swear.
Yes. Yes. So the point in object pronoun, in the subject pronouns, is that the subject pronouns are the ones that perform the action. Right? That is, as Ritu was saying, and object pronouns are the ones on, as she said, on whom the action is being performed. So they're affected by the action. And this is, again, something that we have also done in passive voice and active voice construction. So both of these are very useful to understand in terms of when you use a subject pronoun and an object pronoun. So people tell me it's a controversial statement, but I don't care. But, you know, examples to give, like Ram killed Ravan, right? So he killed him in that sense. Ravan was killed by Ram. So he was killed by Ram, now by him. Now, you know that the him changed in the second sentence to Ram. And in the first sentence, it was Ram was the he, because Ram was the one performing the action of killing. And in the second sentence, Ravan was killed by Ram. He is referring to Ravan because the act of being killed was performed by Ravan. So that's the passive active aspect that comes in. It's important to know this because it becomes an useful tool for also us to learn. And this is also useful in SPOCA, in phrase analysis. That's one of the reasons I'm spending time on this as much here, because the direct object is going to answer the questions who did something or what was done. And the indirect object is going to answer the question to whom was it done, on whom was it done, for whom was it done, for what was it done. So it's basically going to be answering those questions. And the point in term is he told a story. He told what? He told a story. a story is a noun phrase. Why a noun phrase? Why a noun phrase?
So what did he tell when it answers the question what?
Yeah, so we'll come to what phrases are a bit later, but I'm hoping that you can catch up and move back and forth. But he told a story, he told what, and that is why it would be a direct object. He told the story to Rahim, or he spoke to Rahim. He told whom, and so to Rahim. And so that becomes a object indirect. He told, we gave the children books. We gave what? We gave books. We gave to whom? We gave the children. So who is the children becomes object indirect, right? So whenever you have to ask a question of to whom, for whom, on whom, whatever in that sense, that becomes an object indirect, because it also seems that they are not the ones who are directly affected, who are not the direct effect, directly affected by the action. And there's also this element of, a preposition coming in, having to kind of liaise the way for us to understand the action was done on them in that sense. So even within object direct and object indirect, it is important to know the object pronouns and the subject ones in that sense. But of course, the pronouns themselves also make a difference, right? I told them a story. So them I will use as not they a story. I told them a story because it's object indirect. So that's the kind of thing that you will have. We'll come back to the slide a bit again in when we do phrases, but I wanted to make that point clear. Another point that I would like to make clear is this element of form versus function. So we just now looked at the elements in terms of where we said these are the parts of speech. And we identified the parts of speech as these helpful list of words that are there. But every element in a sentence has a form. And this is the form labels, right? Whether it's a noun or a verb, it's a form, right? But the sentence may also perform, the word may have a function in the sentence, which is different. And one of the examples that I like giving is the word up. I went up the stairs. The box was stored up on the cupboard. I want you to drink up the milk, chin up, look up to something of that sort. Look up, look left, look down, look up, right? I went up. So now, if you notice, after this, I have actually given you another aspect that comes in, that this is a preposition. In one of the cases, up is a preposition. In the other one, it is a verbal phrase. It is not just a preposition. It's part of the verbal, it's part of the verb. And in the other, it is an adverb. Now, why do you think there are these differences? Up by itself has all these functions.
Yeah, because we should not restrict the grammar to the word. It's upon the placement of the word where it is in a sentence that the rule changes, or that's where, the function changes.
And so the function, and therefore when you are identifying up, in this sentence, you will identify it as an adverb. In the first sentence, you will identify it as a preposition. And in the next, in the second sentence, you would have identified it as part of the entire verb category. It becomes a verb category because drink up the milk is to finish the milk. And that has a different connotation. It does not mean the same as drink the milk. Drink the milk would just be, taste the milk, have a little bit of it. Drink up the milk is finish the milk. And so drink up is, the word up is important to convey the meaning of what you wanted to say for drink. And that was the entire action. That's why it's a verbal phrase. So it's not going to be a preposition there. Chin up is to be brave. And so that is the element of chin up. It is not the same as chin down, which would have had a different connotation altogether. So those are elements that you have to figure out. And therefore, what you understand from this is that the function in the sentence is more important than the form of the word. So you will have these, especially between conjunctions and prepositions, they really irritate us because they could be sometimes an adverb, sometimes a verbal phrase, sometimes they are a conjunction. Also determiners like pronouns, like this and that. There can be sometimes a pronoun, sometimes a determiner, sometimes, they are connecting in a sense, they're connecting words like which or something of that sort. So you never know. And so you have to figure out in every sentence, you're kind of decoding and you're like a detective figuring out what is the function and then the function determines the form. So you are performing these kind of cognitive acts of meaning making, of understanding the sentence in itself, and also learning a very important rule of life that form is not everything. So, what is more important is ki kya matlab nikal ke aaya, that the function is the important aspect. So hopefully we can figure out on that. And that is where the object direct and everything comes. And I'm not going to come back to it and I'll look at it. The other element is phrases versus clauses. And phrases versus clauses is basically this, a phrase or PH as it is identified. Yes, please do note the short forms. Huh? The noun short form is N, the verb short form is V, adjective, adverb, etc. But the phrase short form is PH, right? A phrase is any one word or a group of words that functions as a noun, a verb, an adjective, an adverb. I don't know. Can you see these? Maybe I should expand those.
It is visible, ma'am.
It is visible,
right? N-P-P-A, small
G. Yeah.
All that is visible. Yes.
So thank you. So, because I wanted to leave out space, and that is, I think, the reason why maybe this will increase the presence. Yeah. So, these elements to a large extent, this would make it automatically bigger. So a phrase is basically something that will enable you to understand that one word could, or a group of words, will function as a noun, will function as an adverb, will function as an adjective, there's something called a genitive phrase. Possession and or a preposition phrase, something that's announced by a preposition. So we'll come to these aspects, but basically that the phrases have a function. They function as the word of a noun or an adjective or an adverb or a verb in that sense. So the four open category classes, and then you have two different aspects, one which is announced by a preposition or another which indicates possession. So those are the two extra ones that you have in among phrases. That's all that we need to figure out for now. I'll come back to this a bit later. Clauses are a group of words that must have a verb in that group. That is what a clause will be. So clause is determined by the fact that there is an action word in that sentence, right? So Jack spoke to his friend, he was tired. All of these kinds of sentences have just one action word, right? Now, this aspect I was doing with something else, so I'm not going to come in with this sentence, but you have, for instance, you can have a sentence, an element such as he was tired. What is the verb in this? Was. And so you have one clause. He was tired because he had not eaten. Or he was hungry. Let's make life simpler for ourselves. Because he was hungry. How many verbs in this?
Two main verbs and two helping verbs.
Where are the two helping verbs?
Ma'am, the was in this is the helping verb.
Only was is acting as the main verb in the sentence.
Yeah. Tired is an adjective. Hungry is an adjective.
Was is acting as the main verb.
This is the main verb. He was sleeping since it was since he was jet lagged, just because I wanted to give something. So he was jet lagged. In this case, again, he was is just the verb and jet lagged is the adjective. And in the first case, he was sleeping, the entire thing is a verb that comes in. So that's something that we'll have to look at. So good for pointing out, but the fact that we will come to these sentence types that we will focus on, I will try and do that first now. But the clause will have to have a verb or an action word in it in that sense. So primarily, when you're looking at the clauses and the phrases, and we'll come to this part again, there are different types of clauses, there are different types of phrases. So I'll just do that. But before I do that, since we were looking at the tense, let me just identify for y'all, what are the different types of tenses that you have? Is just three types, past, present, and future. What you have in those tenses is aspects, simple past, simple present, simple future, continuous past, past continuous, present continuous, future continuous, past perfect, present perfect, future perfect, and something that we don't have in Hindi or Marathi language or anything of that sort, the perfect continuous, the present perfect continuous or the past perfect continuous. We don't have that element. So can you tell me, why do we use these tenses and what do they really imply in terms of stylistic analysis? Because I'm actually combining question two and three together to a large extent. But what do they mean? Why do we use... For instance, let's take up this. Had eaten, ate, and has eaten all mean that the action is done with. I finished eating, right? That's what all of these, had eaten, ate, have eaten, I have eaten, mean. Why do we use anything? Why can't we just say I ate and ate? Why say I have eaten? Why say I had eaten? Kyun? Main khana kha chuki thi, maine khana khaya. मैंने खाना खाया था मैं खाना खा चुकी थी एंड मैं खाना खा चुकी हूँ सेम थिंग हिंदी आल्सो
यू ऑल टॉक अबाउट टाइम दे टॉक अबाउट अ टाइम इन द पास्ट बट समटाइम्स इट कैन बी स्पोकन इन द फॉर्म ऑफ जस्ट नाउ एज इन आई जस्ट फिनिश्ड इट और देन टॉकिंग अबाउट मे बी वे बैक इन टाइम आई फिनिश्ड इट बोथ कम अंडर द कैटेगरी ऑफ द पास्ट टेंस बट द टाइम डिफरेंस एज इन Maybe that's what it tries to show.
Or maybe Could they're be? Trying to show
how far in the past have these actions been taken.
But would
how
that
far
not,
apart?
But would that not be something that you would want to deal with in terms of trying to see? I could just say that I ate the meal, you know, 2 minutes ago. I ate the meal 10 hours ago. I ate the meal, 5 days ago. Why do I need to use I had eaten?
Maybe when I'm saying something else linked to it, some incident happened the moment I finished eating. Something like that?
Yes.
Yes, so it is showing the action continuity in the past, but related to some other incident which happened at that particular time before or after it.
True. So that is one important aspect that you will have to figure out in this element of tenses, is that you need to understand that tenses have a particular function, right? So it is not just going to be I had eaten the meal or I ate the, I wrote this or anything of that sort. So just let's look up the perfect aspect out here. At any point in time, tense is a matter of perspective. Time is a matter of perspective. And you know this, there are times when, and every time now that COVID-19 is there, I don't get to see this, but otherwise in college, there are these people who they have two different subjects. So they go to do different classes and then they come out of a 50-minute lecture class and then they meet each other as if they are in Kumbh Mela mein bichde hue 20 saal se nahi mile hue judwa bhayan aur bhai or whatever. You know them, they hug each other and they scream and shout and you're looking at them and saying, you just had a 50-minute break apart. And then there are these other people who come like after 4 months and then they just nod their head and they're like, ha, abhi to mile the, right? Like, what's the big deal? It was just like, 4 months ago, it's not a great thing in time. So time is always a matter of perspective. It is not just about the fact that, it's not just a statement that comes in. And I think if you've watched the Mahabharata and the beginning of what Kal is and the dialogue, you get those aspects that it is a matter of perspective across cultures. So why do I differentiate between I ate an apple, I had eaten an apple, and I have eaten an apple, which are all these things that come before the now, is you need to understand what the effect of these would be. So let me take this up. So this is the first part that I wanted to give as an example. Let's go back to this perfect aspect itself. Why would I use a perfect aspect? Because that is the point that we're making, is what is the difference between I had reached the bus stop when the bus left, which is the second action, right? I had reached the bus stop when the bus left, because we are saying that I had eaten and then I ate. That is, you were pointing that out, right? So the first action is I reached the bus stop, then the bus left. I reached the bus stop when the bus left. Is there a difference? They seem to be parallel actions. Can I get into the bus when for sentence two? According to me,
there is a possibility.
According to me, this is the true Mumbaikar test.
Yes, you reach there is
the
a
train, you reach the station and the train leaves, you still get into the train, you're a true Mumbaikar. Not in COVID-19 situations, but otherwise. Okay. And you see people running after the bus, right? When the bus, because they reach the stop and the bus left just at that time, and they run after the bus and they get into the bus. So I reached the bus stop and the bus left. Parallel actions. Now, obviously, from there, you get another possibility. There's a permutation combination that comes in that says that I reached, it happened parallelly. And obviously, these are both simple past tense. Both of them happen at the same time. In the first sentence, there was a sequence of actions, right? I had reached the bus stop first, then the bus left. Should I have got into the bus?
I could have. I mean, if
So you had the choice. And if you then say, I did not get into the bus, it was your choice to not get into the bus. So now the story unfolds. Whereas I reached the bus stop and the bus left, and you know that you could still get into the bus, but you had to take efforts to do that. I reached the bus stop and the bus had left.
So
can I get into the bus?
No possibility. The bus is already gone.
Yes. Now I need to be Superman or Rajnikant or someone to be able to get into the bus, because that's what robot showed, right? The train had left and still he flies in. So yes, you have to be this. Now you get these aspects that come in. And by the way, every competitive exam tests you on this logic fail that we don't recognize. This is logic that is really being tested. I had eaten the cookies my mother baked. Can you read this first sentence that I have put in out here that I've now highlighted? I had eaten the cookies my mother baked. Is that a correct sentence?
I don't think so. I had eaten the cookies my mother baked.
If you already ate the cookies, which is what I had eaten the cookies, where was your mother baking them afterwards?
Yes.
In your tummy. And that's the point. When you're looking at it, you did not find the logic fail, because you were like, I understand, my mother baked the cookies, I ate those cookies. But it is an incorrect, grammatically incorrect sentence, because it's a logic fail, because first you ate the cookies, then your mother baked them, which is just not seemingly logical. How did your mother bake them after you ate them? Kind of thing, right? So perfect aspects are used in all competitive exams, your GMAT and IELTS and SAT exams and all these bank exams are all flooded with these kinds of questions which say, identify the error in the sentence, or which of these sentences are erroneous. And they love this, because people all over the world just don't get the logic that is wrong here. And what was the logic? The fact that you had to recognize that there is a sequence of actions that just could not have existed in the way that it is being presented. So this is one element of why we do linguistic and stylistic analysis. And I wish we did this way in school as well, because students can do it. How does it imply in literature? Why are we doing this in literature? And the reason for that is where you're looking at this, you know, I've again given you a sentence aspect. I reached the staff room to submit the assignment, right? I reached the staff room to submit the assignment, but the teacher left. What does it tell me about the teacher's behavior? I reached the staff room to submit the assignment, the teacher left. What does it tell me about the teacher?
The teacher left on time, maybe it was time to just go. It was just the last bell rang and it was time for everyone to go. So
she was a very punctual teacher, yes. But she's not a kind teacher.
Yeah. To some extent,
very kind.
Yes.
You're not going to say she's a bad teacher, but she's not this wonderful, good, loving, yes. lovable teacher that is there because she ignored the student primarily.
Yeah.
I had reached the staff room and to submit the assignment and the teacher left.
So simultaneously the teacher left.
No, now it is what? I had reached the staff room, then the teacher left. In the first sentence, I reached the staff room and the teacher left to submit
then
the assignment.
The teacher left. So first
it
you
could
reached
have
and
been,
then the teacher went.
Yeah. So it could have been that maybe there are two doors to the staff room and I entered the staff room from one door and the teacher left from the other door. Maybe she didn't see me. But I had reached the staff room to submit the assignment and the teacher still left. So I had reached, first I reached, then the teacher left. Now she's definitely the khadoos teacher who doesn't like to see my face. And who just goes about her business and does not want to accept it and wants to teach the student a lesson, right? So that is the teacher. Now you can get character from the fact that you understand the sequence of actions. I changed that same sentence. I changed the tense and I changed the sequence of actions. I reached the staff room, but the teacher had left.
You reached late when the teacher had already left. So you were the late.
Now the student is this indisciplined character, does not even submit the assignment on time in the class and not even in the staff room. Horrible student. Iske saath sympathy karne ki koi zarurat nahi. You know, I don't want to have sympathy with him. So you realize how your attitude towards the student also will be defined by all of this. And this is very subconscious, by the way. This is not going to be done at a conscious level. You will do this subconsciously. It's not that you're going to parse the sentence and say, oh, past perfect isme use hua hai, usme. That's not how we do it. We're just looking at the logic and saying, you reached this classroom late. I mean, from this, what I deduce is you reached the classroom late. If you are reaching the classroom late, you are indisciplined. If you're indisciplined as a student, of course, the teacher has all the right to shout at you and I have no sympathy for you. All of this as processing has happened within a split second. You can do this with your, and I give this example all the time. You can try doing this with your, you know, when people come to your house or when people are trying to feed you. If you want that extra samosa, you will just say, "Maine samosa khaya tha." But if you don't want that samosa because you're on a diet for some odd reason, you will then say, "Main samosa kha chuki hu." You know, you will give those kinds of, try this. Chai pee chuki hu versus chai pee thi. Because then the person will be like, chai pee thi na, abhi ek aur le lo. And chai pee chuki hu is like, acha isko disturb nahi karna. If someone is doing a call for, you know, is calling you up and asking you for donations, which they do every year, financial year end, etc. And you're like, I have given donations. Bikhari ko bhi bol do, maine wahan pe chanda de diya hai, de chuki hu, whatever. And that bikhari also knows, inse dal, yahan pe dal nahi galegi. And so they move on. Whereas you just say, maine diya tha, and that bikhari also knows, this is not about education. This is not about parsing the sentence and figuring out past perfect, present perfect, or anything like that. It's just about understanding. And that is what writers, educators, consciously use to, you know, give an effect to the reader and figure out this. The reader is not doing this at a conscious level, but automatically we get these understandings and there is a meaning making that is happening here. So that's one element that you could be looking at in terms of tenses, right? The other, why do we use the ing form? You know, why do we say I am eating or I am living? Why can't we just say I lived? I live in Mumbai. Why do I say I am living in Mumbai? What is the difference?
It shows a continuity that I'm still living in Mumbai.
Okay.
It's showing presently that also I am still living.
Yes.
In Mumbai, when you were saying, I am living, it's showing that in this moment also, yes.
But I live in Mumbai also. I am still living in Mumbai, no?
There is a, meaning you have been living in the past, you still live, and there's a possibility that you might live in the future also. But when you say, I am living, you are talking just about the present moment that I am living. There is nothing that tells you in the future that there is a possibility that she might live. I can change my city.
I would have to think twice about it, because not necessary when I'm doing a past, present, future, it is not necessary that I am living in Mumbai means that I will not, I mean, I live in Mumbai does not mean that I don't live in Mumbai anymore. And think about your geography textbooks that talk about the earth rotates around the sun versus, right? The earth rotates on its axis and revolves around the sun,
I say I live in Mumbai, could it be we are pinpointing the geographic location as in place?
No, I live in Mumbai. Talking about the prolonged time. I live in Mumbai.
Prolonged time? So your action is going on since a long time.
Yeah, so just to cut that short in terms of the conversation, because I'm very conscious of the time thing. But otherwise, yes, I do allow for all this, you know, because I believe that you will remember better when you are constructing it for yourself, but I'm cutting it short. You can do this exercise,
yes.
Right? I played Ludo for 2 hours versus I was playing Ludo for 2 hours. And this is an example given, but think about anything that you do in life. When you are attending a lecture and you are tired and sick and, or do this even with your, you know, if you are parents or you have parents, definitely you've all been children. All of us have been children. Parents always come to us and tell us, you were talking on the phone for 2 hours. Even aadhe ghante ka conversation hua to wo 2 ghante ka. And they always say, tum baat kar rahe the. Do they say, tumne baat kiya? No. They will say, tum baat kar rahe the. You were talking on the phone for 2 hours. When you study, do they ever say, oh, you were studying for 2 hours? Or do they say, you studied only for 2 hours?
Only for 2 hours.
Isn't that how they say it? And why suddenly that 2 hours, the same quantum of 2 hours, in one case was like you were talking for 2 hours. And in another, it was like you only studied for 2 hours. You
so it is the action which determines
the emphasis heaviness on the
emphasis on
it is the emphasis
yes, drama
of the duration
effect.
Of the action. It is the dramatic effect, exactly. It is about how I feel about the drama. So when I come out of a lecture where I'm like, isna pakaya mujhe, I'm like, you know, we were in that call and we were listening to that person for 2 hours. And if you liked a movie which was 3 hours long, you would say, "Arre, yeah, movie dekha yaar. It was so good. It was such a good movie that I watched." That's how you come out of a movie hall. And with the same thing with the lecture is like, oh God, we were sitting there for 2 hours or 50 minutes or 1 hour, whatever. You understand how we automatically emphasize duration. All of us use this, by the way. What I'm giving you is not a new thing. Also, the continuous for another reason is the drama. The possibility of drama, we've already said, it is a possibility of interruption. So it creates a suspense, right? I was asking you, what is the difference between he was driving on the road and it was raining versus he drove along the road, it rained. Is that it creates a sense of suspense. Why does it create a sense of suspense? Because there's always a possibility of interruption. I was sleeping. Ghanti baji. I was sleeping and their bell rang. There's a possibility that I continued sleeping. There's a possibility that I stopped sleeping and I woke up. So the possibility of interruption creates that suspense. And you don't know. It could go either way. That is why it is suspense, right? And there is a parallelism in action. There's 3 reasons why you use a continuous aspect. You use a, whether it's in the past, present, or future, you use only for these 3 reasons primarily. Emphasize the duration of action, indicate parallelism, indicate possibility of time. Why do you use a perfect? You use a perfect to indicate, you know, the element of sequence of actions, emphasize completion of action. And I don't have it written down, but I can write it out for perfect. You use a perfect for 3 reasons alone. One is to emphasize completion of action. You know, that ye kaam ho chuka hai. Did you finish your homework? I have done it. You know, main khana kha chuki hoon, or I spoke to you. So that is one of the reasons. That's also drama, by the way. Another is the reason why you may use the perfect tense is, I'm just going to drag it out here. Hopefully it will be all right. You may use the perfect aspect for another reason. You may use that perfect aspect to indicate sequence of actions. Right? The sequence of actions may be there. So there could be, in a sense, you know.
What happened first, what happened second?
Yes, yes. As we studied out here. And the third reason why you have it is that it also indicates, from here you realize, it indicates the possibility of, it indicates a future action, right? Something else happened after this. That's another thing that it indicates. That's what the perfect will indicate. Indicate sequence of actions and indicates a secondary action, right? Like, I had eaten an apple, or I had dropped my pen. And from there, you realize that from these actions, you realize that I had dropped a pen versus I just dropped a pen. The difference would be that I just want to indicate that I had dropped a pen, then something else happened after that. I dropped a pen. It's just a statement of fact that I just dropped it. I don't necessarily indicate something else in the future, right? So I had given you my homework, which is why parents and teachers love telling this. I had told you. The most favorite dialogue, right? I had told you, which is basically telling you, मैंने बोल चुकी थी, अभी तुमने ये काम नहीं किया, तुम्हें ये करना था, तुमने नहीं किया. Your fault. It is all your thing. It is not my fault. It is your fault. The indirect implied action is that it is implying a future action. It is implying ki I'm not going to help you anymore. I had told you. So, you know, if I had told you, then you should have figured it out yourself, right? That is where it comes from. So these are the reasons why you use a perfect or a continuous. And the perfect continuous you use because you want to, you know, bring in a bridge between the two. I'm not going to get into that again, but you could. And so I will, what do I want to do? Yeah, I'm also very conscious of the running out of time. Okay, so why is this important? Is that you need to know the tenses in order to be able to identify clauses. I'm spending so much of time on all of this because you need to know the tenses in order to identify the clauses. You need to understand the difference that comes from all of these cases of usage that occurs. And so I might just copy paste some of these elements. But one element that you will have to think about in these focus areas of tenses and all of these is also to understand how newspaper articles, et cetera, might, give you the tenses, how they might try and identify for you the clauses and phrases and everything that comes in between. And let me do this. Yeah. I'm also going to go over the passive voice construction for a reason right out here, that it will help you understand the passive voice construction to some extent, because that is another part of where your clause analysis comes in from. So the passive voice and the active voice, this is the active voice, right? I wrote a letter, simple past. The passive voice is a letter was written by me. No.
Sorry. That will become the
The past. So I had So the subject is I had written a letter, and in the passive voice, the subject, the object becomes the subject. Right? We have studied this again. Sixth standard se humne ye sikha hua hai that the object becomes a subject. Subject becomes an object. Now my question is this: why do we use passive voice? Why do we want to use a passive voice?
Is it again the same emphasis being given on the action? Because when you say I wrote a letter, a letter has been written by me. So again,
and the by emphasis... me is not even required.
Yes.
Yeah. So you know, when you are looking at that action, the fact is that when you say a holiday has been declared or the exams have been postponed, who performed the action is unknown. And even if it is known, he is at the end of the sentence, not important. So you are basically focusing on what the main idea is and not the doer. In the active voice, you're focusing on the doer. I wrote it. I did this. You know, it is me who wrote the letter. The government declared a holiday. Not just anyone. The government declared it. The teacher said that, you know, it is a holiday tomorrow. Not me. It's a holiday tomorrow. Just tells me that's a holiday tomorrow. A holiday has been declared. It just tells me that. But now I'm telling you the teacher said. So that's an important aspect of focusing on the doer in active voice. In passive voice, it is not the doer. The doer is not even important. The doer is inconsequential and may sometimes not even be mentioned. Right? So that is the point in between active and passive voice. And so that's important to note. Also, I would like to draw your attention to the fact, because just like Priyanka did, many of us do not do this exercise. I would really recommend that you do this. Write out the passive voice construction, just as there was the active voice construction here. Like I ate, I had eaten, I ate, etc. The passive voice construction will also be useful so that you know how to recognize these forms, right? And I have given that to you so you can, you know, and you can fill in the blanks, but this is basically it. I'm not going to read it out again. Again, these are things we've been doing since sixth standard. I'm just asking you to revise and go over them, but it is useful to look at these elements because we often forget. In fact, the mistake made by the fact that, you know, is written and is tired, he was tired. And the reason why the tired got recognized as a verb is because you're very accustomed to passive voice construction where was is being used as a helping verb that tells you more about when the tense was. And this is important because that's why we make those mistakes and we don't recognize the tired aspect. You have to understand that the verb is an action word. Is tired the action that is being performed, or is tired a description of the person's, you know, state of being? That will be a difference between the recognizing a verb and a non-verb. So that's something that you would have to look at. Why are these important? These are important because you have to identify between finite verbs and non-finite verbs. What does it mean when I say finite verbs and non-finite verbs?
Finite is when the action is completed, and non-finite is it when it is still...
No. Finite is when I can know when the action took place. And I can tell you that it was in the past, or it was in the present, or it was in the future. And non-finite is when I don't know when the action took place. Not from that action word. I don't know when the action took place. So I've given you two different elements out here. I was standing on the balcony and I waved out to her. So I was standing on the balcony tells me that the action was in the past. Whether that's continuous or not, it was in the past. And I waved out to her, right? Standing on the balcony, I waved out to her. Difference, isn't it? Now here, there is a difference in terms of from the word standing, do I know when the action took place?
No, standing on the balcony doesn't give me any indication of time as such.
So you are dependent on the rest of the sentence to figure out when the action took place, right? Standing does not tell us when the action took place. And I've already written it out for anyone who likes to read more than listen. Waved is there in the past, and so I understand it. But I could also write standing on the balcony, I will wave out to her. That's a prediction I'm making for the future. That while I'm standing on the balcony, I will be waving out to her. Standing on the balcony, he waves out to her. Standing on the balcony, I waved out to her. So standing now then is contingent upon my understanding of when the action took place is dependent on the rest of the sentence. But standing by itself just tells me the action was in progress, but I don't know when it was in progress. Was it progress in the past? Was it in progress in the present? Is it in progress in the present? Or will it be in progress in the future? I don't know. That is a non-finite clause. Please, students, if you are not clear, you want me to explain, please, type in the chat, unmute yourselves, and let me know, all right? But these are the reasons why it is finite and non-finite. So non-finite tells me action, but does not tell me the tense. Now, that seems okay. In finite, you know that all I have to know is there could be passive voice construction, there can be active voice construction, as we have here. So I'm not going over it. Similarly, with non-finite, we have three types of non-finite verbs, actions, state of verb states. You have the infinitive, which is generally a planned or a desired action. To study abroad was a dream of mine. To study abroad is a dream of mine. To study abroad will be an achievement of mine in the future. To study, does it tell me, did the action get completed necessarily? For instance, if I say to study abroad was a dream of mine, did I study abroad?
No, it doesn't tell you that. It just gives you an idea.
But it could be that I studied abroad. It could be that I did not study abroad.
Yes.
You know, it just tells me that it was a desired action. It was a planned action, which is why a lot of curse words are in this kind of a thing. Tumhe kutta kha jaye kind of thing, you know, let the dog bite you, let this person do that. So it's all in this kind of to do kind of an action, you know, in that infinitive aspect. You don't know when the action took place in that sense. But you do understand that it is a planned or desired action. Present participle or the cling tells me the action is in progress. It is an ongoing action, like standing. So he came running. He comes running. He will come running. But running, now this is the point. Why is running a separate verb out here? Or we had the same sentence that you're looking at, right? Standing on the balcony, he waves out to her.
So running is your main verb, and when you're writing came, comes, will come, which is basically telling us...
Came is the main verb, not running. The main verb will be the finite verb, ideally. ING will not be the finite verb will be the main verb that you have, and non-finite verbs will generally be subordinate actions that come in. Standing on the balcony, I wave out to her. Let's go back to that earlier sentence, which also gave the same sentences.
Ma'am, I have this one doubt when I look at this sentence, he came running. Does not running qualify to be
an adverb?
Gerund?
No, not a gerund. Gerund is a verbal noun. This can't be a gerund. It can be an adverb that you can look at. He came how? He came running. Running is my favorite. Gerund will be when I say running is my favorite activity. Then what is my favorite activity? Running. That is a gerund.
Okay, so if running was in place of a subject, then probably it could have been a gerund.
Or an object. I like running. I like reading. What do I like? I like reading.
And here running, you say, is an adverb.
It can be identified as an adverb. He came how? He came running.
Okay.
But it will depend, because I was actually taking it from another sentence altogether. It will depend on the clause as such. So I'm just going to take this off just from a point of view of making it less tedious and just use the same sentences from here. Standing on the balcony, I will wave out to her. Standing on the balcony, I wave out to her. These are kinds of sentences that you could be also looking at. And figuring out from here, standing on the balcony, I waved out to her, right? So this could be copy and paste out here. So this could be your sentence that you are looking at in terms of the clauses, where you have standing as such, which tells me that there was an action, because I just want to make it very clear that this is a separate action. That's the only reason I'm doing this. But standing on the balcony is a separate action. And so... And so all of these standing on the balcony becomes a kind of a clause which will deal with, which will deal with these elements of So standing, right? Now, from standing, I don't know when the action took place. I only know that the action is something that featured, that was in progress when some other action of bathing was going to be happening. There was going to be a parallel action, a simultaneous action of standing. But whether it was in the past or it is in the present or in the future, will be in the future, I don't get to know from this place, right? So that makes it very clear that it is a verb, it is an activity, but it doesn't tell me when the action took place. So that is where your present participle comes in. The past participle is when you talk about an action that is completed. And we did this in second, third standard in school sometimes. You had at the back of your book a chart of saying past participle forms, horrible things. Be, was, been, if you remember. All those nonsense things that you did. So especially if you were in state board and CBSE, ICSE is much better at not making you do this. But yes, he could not pronounce the words. Which words? The ones that were written on the manuscript. Now, obviously, were written is not there. It is only written on the manuscript that is there. And that is why it is an klen. It is not telling me about the action adequately enough. It is not telling me about the it's not telling me about the action in terms of the tense. It is telling me action complete, but it doesn't tell me that the action is complete when. That doesn't come through. So completed action, but when the action was completed, we don't. So that is the difference between the klen and the non-finite verbs. Now, just because I'm telling you all of this does not mean you're going to get it. Until and unless you practice enough, you're not going to get this. So you need to come up with sentences and try and organize them and figure out, do I know the tense? Do I not know the tense? And, you know, deal with them to that extent. So let me come back to this element of phrases and clauses. We will do that first. If we are dealing with phrases, as we already said, phrases are going to be one word or a chunk of words that either act as a noun, adjective, adverb, or a verb phrase primarily. They may also indicate possession, like, you know, genitive phrases do, or they may be a group of words that is announced by a preposition. So there are two extra ones that don't actually have a form as in that sense, but they are there. Clauses must have a verb in it. So there could be even one word sentence, which is a complete sentence, which is just sit, for instance. You know, that tells me you should sit down right now. That's a simple sentence. That's main clause. You also may have something where, you know, language is not gradual, generational in that sense. There is one verb in the sentence, so it's a main clause. It happens because of external events. It is a main clause. There is only one verb in all of these sentences. There are many phrases within the sentences. So for instance, can you tell me how many phrases are there in, within a clause there may be phrases. So how many phrases are there in sentence one? One, and it is a verb phrase. Yes. How many sentences are there in sentence two?
One only, again, because it's still again a verb.
Would this be a verb? Would down be a verb?
Down is not a verb. That is a preposition here.
Yeah. Is it a preposition here?
Sit down.
Yes, down. Talking about the place.
Look left, look right, sit down.
Adverb. Telling us more about where to sit. Modifying the...
So this is a VP. Please note that form labels are going to be praised above. It acts as a predicate, and I will go over these elements for you, but it acts as a predicate. And the reason I'm speeding this up is also because I assume some of this has been done in school. And even if you don't remember all of it, at least when I'm talking, it will refresh your memories, however long ago it was. We were tortured, and you always remember torture very well. So hopefully. So down in this case would be an AVP. But even if you say it is a PP, it could still be a prepositional phrase, right? And it would be, what is it telling me more about? It is telling me more about how, you know, how the sitting should happen. And so it is an adverbial that works in this phrase. So there are two verb phrases. I mean, there are two phrases here. I'm going to come back to phrases, but this is what I wanted to indicate, that within a clause, there may be a phrase. Now, what are the different types of phrases? Let's first do the types of phrases. And because I was talking to you about phrases, you have a noun phrase. It is the equivalent of a noun. I cannot make this chart any simpler than this. This is like, you know, no one does it this simplified, but it is really simplifying it to a large extent. And there are nuances. So do understand that grammar is a little bit more complex, but I hope this chart helps you understand what to do. So the phrase form is a noun phrase. There is one type, right? The form will always come as a subscript. It will be down, right? So notice the fact that your phrase is coming in the noun phrase, right? Raj. Raj is a noun. The big hotel. The main idea in that sentence is a noun, therefore a noun phrase. The hotel is the main word, and that is why it becomes a noun phrase. So the chunk of words is going to be equivalent to a noun. The functions, which come as a superscript at the top, can be a subject, can be an object. Very often they are either the subject or the object. Noun phrases generally function as a subject or an object, right? So I have also given you what a subject is: S, predicate, P, object, object direct, object indirect, complement adverbial. So we'll come to what the complement, etc., is. The verb phrase is always a predicate. That's the easiest one. You get the verb, you do it as a verb phrase, and you get a predicate. That's done, right? So that's a predicate, right? It will be a predicate where you're looking at, it could be in the finite verb, it could be non-finite verb, but it's a verb phrase and it is a predicate. Adjective phrases are things that will tell you more about the noun or the pronoun. It will be equivalent to an adjective. So it could be that there is an adverb within the adjective phrase that is describing the adjective, but the main idea of that chunk is an adjective, right? That is how you identify it as an adjective phrase. It always acts as a complement. It complements the noun or the pronoun. That's what an adjective phrase generally does. An adverb phrase, AVP, is something that tells me more about the verb, sometimes about another adverb or an adjective, but mostly when you're looking at an adverb phrase, these will be the ones that tell you more about the verb in this sense, right? And the adverb is going to act as an adverbial. It answers the question when, where, how, why, right? Those are the four questions that it would answer in the sentence. He ran fast. How did he run? He ran fast. He shouted angrily. How did he shout? Angrily, because that was the emotion he felt. Not he shouted happily, but he shouted angrily, right? It tells me more about that. He came on time, right? So that's an adverbial, but that's now announced by a preposition. So when the chunk of words is announced by a preposition, like into, or he came on time, when did he come? On time. So on is a preposition. He went into the room. So then into is a preposition. And that is why it would be a PP, a preposition phrase that is announced by the preposition and acts as an adverbial. Why? Because here it says he went. Where did he go? Into the room. He came on time. When did he come? He came on time. So if I'm writing this, he came on time, right? The way that you would do it is you would identify he as a noun phrase. What would be its function?
Head word. A subject?
Yes. Subject. It will be at the top. So the subject is at the top because he is the one performing the action. What is came?
Verb phrase. The verb.
Yes, so that should be easiest to identify, verb phrase, and then the predicate. So Ritu was also at the beginning of the class asking me, what kind of questions can we get in the MCQ section? Some of what I'm dealing with you right now, like, you know, the fact that the function label comes at the top, that's a kind. Where is it placed? Is it placed at the top? Is it placed at the bottom? Is it placed before the word? Is it placed after the word, right? So that should be something that you can get as a theoretical question. Another kind of application question that you can get is a question that I asked you for the earlier slide, or even that I can ask you for this slide, where I can ask you how many phrases are there in this sentence. You know, he came on time. How many phrases are there in the sentence? 0, 1, 2, 3. How many phrases are there?
Sorry, which one?
Three phrases. So that could be a question that you can get. How many phrases are there in the sentence, right? It could be that I ask you, or not I ask you, but anyone can ask you that he came on time. And the kind of questions that you could have is, is there an object, which of the following does not exist in the sentence? Subject, predicate, adverbial, object, right? So it is not there in the sentence. So you can read it and figure out that there is no object in the sentence. Right now there is an adverbial, there is a subject, there is a predicate, but there's no object. So you get how the questions could be framed. You still have an application, but now they're more theoretical in that sense. Now,
tell me what an adverbial is again?
Adverbial is something that answers it basically performs the function of an adverb. So it will answer the questions when, where, how, what, why, right? So that is when, not how, what, sorry. When, where, how, why. Yeah. So basically it is an adverb in that sense. So that is what an adverbial would be doing. And a complement is more like an adjective. It will describe the noun in that sense. Yeah. Right? So that's where you come from. So the only other type that you have is the genitive phrase, which is possession. So this comes always within a larger phrase. Genitive phrase is a phrase within a phrase. And so the genitive phrase is basically his book. So his is possession. And so you have to identify it as his and then, or Jack's book in the case, and Jack's becomes a genitive phrase that is modifying the book. So this is the only exception that you have to all the other phrases in that sense. Everything else is really very form-based, but the first four are basically equivalent of a noun, verb, adjective, adverb. The preposition phrase is announced by a preposition. It may act as a noun phrase. It may be an adjective, or it may be adverb, generally adverbs, but it may be that. But it is announced by a preposition. So that is why it's a preposition phrase. And the genitive phrase is, it is telling you, ye possession hai. So that is why the genitive phrase, right?
Does this H stand for?
Yeah, so the H, if you note, have I not given that out here? Yeah, so the H in these sentences basically stands for a head word versus modifier. So if you look at these sentences out here at the beginning, this is the top one, the big hotel, you realize that the main word, it's a chunk. The big hotel, the is telling me more about the hotel, big is telling me more about the hotel is the main idea. And there is a descriptor of the hotel that is coming in, such as the and big. So the is modifying hotel, big is modifying hotel, and the main word or the head word is hotel. So H is standing for head word.
Okay, thank you, ma'am.
And that is how you identify whether it's a noun phrase or not a noun phrase. So for instance, in this, it is an AJP. In the third sentence, it is an AJP because very happy, happy is the main word. Very is telling me more about happy, so it is modifying happy. So the head word is happy, and therefore the form of the phrase will be adjective phrase. So that is how you would have those differences. Generally for complement, they will generally come after the verb to be, to look, to appear, to feel, to seem. Those are where your adjective phrases come. That is another way of identifying whether they are adjectives or not. That's one of the quicker shortcuts, so to speak, right? Okay, please do note, these are indications and I'm going fast because I'm going to give you time. Tomorrow we don't have a class. You can look up all of these links and everything and practice a bit. And then on Wednesday, actually ask more questions where we will solve more clauses and phrases. But I want to go over the entire gamut of what these are today, for you to have an idea. I know some of you will feel tired, so just bear with me for another 10-15 minutes. 10 minutes, ma'am.
Excuse me, ma'am. Can we get the recording later?
Yeah, I will be uploading it on YouTube and putting this up. So yes, you will get
thank
this
so much, ma'am.
Tomorrow, by tomorrow latest. Yes, on the Telegram group itself. Yeah.
Okay, ma'am.
So yeah, and I will just create a playlist and give you the playlist. So I'll keep adding to the playlist because I don't have the patience to give individual video links every time. So and also the playlist becomes easier for you to track everything in that it falls in that form. Okay, so clauses is this aspect of clause. You have two kinds of clause. I mean, you have the main clause, which is like, you know, simple sentences. The question, the written question is relevant, or he is happy. There is one verb, there is one action, and that is all that you have. They are independent clauses. There is nothing in terms of a function that they perform. They just exist and they are part of the sentence overall. In terms of subordinate clauses, which is what SCL is really, the subordinate clauses and subordination is again something that will ask you in terms of noun. So the noun clause acts as a noun. It is the equivalent of a noun. So the question asked is relevant. Can you see the difference between this? The written question in this written is an adjective. I can also change this written question to the question written. I mean, I could have done that. You know, instead of asking the question written, I could have asked the question asked 10 minutes. So the question written or the question asked. Now here, because of the way that it is framed, in one, written is an adjective because it is coming before the noun and it is describing the noun. In the other, it is a verb that is not complete. It is not telling, I mean, it is a verb that is complete in the sense that the question written, which question, the question that was written. So it is basically actually an NCLEN. I should not have given it as NCL. It's an NCLEN that would have been there, which tells me the action is complete of being asked or something like that. You know, the question that was asked, the question that was written is relevant. The question that was asked in class yesterday is still relevant today. That's how you would have it. Now, that kind of a clause, because this entire chunk has a verb in it that is telling me what is relevant, that becomes a noun clause, right? And the noun clause can be a complete noun clause, or it could be encle or enclen or encling, to go back to the verbs types of infinitive non-finite verbs that we had, cle, cling, or clen, in addition to just being the clause, which is CL. Right? And I will revise, don't worry, I will revise this on Wednesday. But for now, just try and see where the chunks are lying. There's a relative clause. This is the equivalent of an adjective. So unlike in grammar, when we did in school adjective clauses, here we don't do adjective clauses. We are only looking them at relative clauses, but their function is an adjective. They're easy to identify generally because they always come before or immediately after a noun or a pronoun. Because they're describing the noun or the pronoun, they are generally easier to come. So the question he asked, now the question changes. Now the question is which question, the one that he asked, right? So the question he asked is relevant. So which question is relevant? The one he asked. So the relative clause is modifying the question or the noun. It acts as an adjective. It comes within a noun phrase or something. The adverb clause, ACL, answers the question when, where, how, why. And he came when it was too late. When did he come? When it was too late. So that chunk of when it was too late is answering the question when he came. And it has a verb in it. So if I gave he came on time does not have a verb, so no clause. It's just one simple main clause. He came when it was too late, then I have my clause and subordinate clause, and the subordination is adverb clause, and it functions as an adverbial because it answers when, where, how, why. Preposition clause, like preposition phrases, are announced by prepositions. They may be relative mein ho sakta hai, adverb mein ho sakta hai, but they are announced by a preposition. So which room? The one in which he stood, but it is a preposition clause. Why? Because in, it is announced by in, which is a preposition. He operated with a pen, for there were no scalpels. Why did he great in that sense, in the sense that is an adverb. But here, because the word for is there, you would have it as a preposition clause. The other one, so these are very similar to your phrase types. Hai na? The one that you realize is, yahan pe koi verb clause nahi hai, kyunki verbs clauses ke andar hai. So you don't have a verb clause separately. You have a separate, like the genitive phrase in the phrase analysis, here you have another type of a clause, which is called a comparative clause. That's also generally easy to identify because comparison, right? It is generally easy to identify. I'm taller than him. I am taller than he is. In that sense, right? So he is a separate verb. And so I have a comparative clause of he is. In the first sentence, I am taller than him. There is no verb. There is only one singular verb. I am taller. I am. And therefore, it is just one main clause. You know? So that is what your comparison comes in. And the comparison can act as an object. It really depends. In this case, I'm taller than he is. What will its function be? Will it be an object? What will be the function of this one? Will it be an object?
The he is part?
Yeah, the he is part.
I'm taller than him. I'm taller than he is.
Does it tell me how tall?
Taller than him.
Than him. Comparison is there. Yeah.
So it tells me how tall? Yeah, the comparison is there. We already identified the form as a comparison. Now the question is, function may complement hai, adverbial hai, subject hai, object hai, what is it?
Would it be an object?
Complement?
What is the function of a complement?
It describes a noun.
Is the he is describing the noun?
Okay, no.
What is it describing? It is describing or giving you additional information about something, but what is it really doing? I already gave you a hint.
About the ask second your person. Questions.
Yeah, but ask your question. What is it giving? What is the second person helping you understand more of?
So I'm I'm taller than whom? Would that be the right question?
Yes.
Whom am I taller than he is? I'm taller than
him. I guess, ma'am, it is a object.
So if you say I'm taller than whom, it will be obviously an object indirect, right?
Yes.
Because it is telling me a comparison in that sense, and it is following aspect that comes through. So you will have to now obviously ask those questions. Therefore, the questions become very important for you to be able to identify. Now, don't worry so much about this, because in the exam, to a large extent, we are asking you to identify. We will give you an underlined part of the sentence or something, and then we will ask you to identify the in that sentence underlined part, like we did in school. You know, he is or something, and is that a comparative clause, or what kind of function label does it have? Generally, we ask you what the form label is. So that is where it will come through. But yes, these are the kinds of questions. Why I wanted to ask you is, these are the kinds of questions that you can have. You may not have a complete sentence analysis. You may just have part of the sentence that you're analyzing. That can come in. Do you get the kinds of questions that you may be asked if it's a written MCQ-based exam? It could be easy. So yeah,
in
go
the
ahead.
Comparative clause, it says, I am taller than he is. So in here, you have just marked he is as the comparative clause. But if you go as per the textbook, I was trying to understand, even with the textbook, it says than he is the entire comparison clause, as the
comparatively in
as generally the that CCA. yeah I know, so you won't be marked wrong to mark the than he is, but than is generally a conjunction and as is a conjunction, like as good as, in that sense it's a paired conjunction, so we keep conjunctions out of clauses, but it is not wrong to include them in there, but yeah, we won't penalize you for it if that's the question. But typically, I mean, if you're asking what grammar, if you're going to leech or anyone, then than will not be part of the clause. It will be outside it simply because it's a conjunction. It is marked as a conjunction. Yeah. Okay.
I wanted to ask something.
Go ahead.
Like the previous question, I am taller than he is. In this, you will mark and give us the part and you will ask us which clause it is for MCQ exam.
Yeah, like me is not just me. There is a team that makes questions, but yes.
Yeah, ma'am.
Primarily.
Yes. Yeah. So thus we have to identify and options will be given and out of that we have to choose the correct
Anji. One. That can actually make your life easier or more difficult depending on how much of the ability you have.
Yes, thank you.
Yeah. So I'm giving you kinds of questions that you can be asked. I already gave you the types of questions like how many phrases are there or how many clauses are there. For instance, another question that can be very easily asked in this is if you give a sentence, I'm taller than him, how many clauses are there in the sentence? 0, 1, 2, 3.
One.
You know, so there is one. How many subordinate clauses are there in this sentence? 0, 1, 2, 3. And then again, so you get those points, right? So there could be that you say 0, but there is a possibility that someone did not read the question properly and then made a mistake. So there could be that, you know, I give the sentence and say how many clauses are there in the sentence and someone read it as main clause and said 1, but it was basically asking you how many clauses are there in the sentence and you should have said 2, right? So those are the kinds that you can have as a question. So this is just one possibility, but I'm giving you types that can be there. Obviously the multiple choice can be exhausted in that sense. There could be a longer sentence than this because short sentences typically students get right. So maybe when we are asking you how many clauses, then we might give you a slightly longer sentence just to make you feel frustrated, right? It's a very application-oriented paper. You don't have to study too much, but you have to remember the points that come in. So coordination comes in where you say, I love tea, but I hate coffee. So there could be two main clauses in a sentence. Or that he loves tea and juice. In that sense, there is within the phrase coordination. This is not as important. This is more important because in this kind of a sentence where you get these two simple sentences, you can be asked how many main clauses are there? And you may want to say, I mean, obviously you have to say two main clauses and they can come within a sentence. So we have done this in school, but I'm just reminding ourselves that these are the case that comes in. If you were solving in the paper, you would have maybe wanted to do something of this kind where you were writing, the coach taught him fielding. This is one thing that someone else was asking. I don't remember who exactly, but someone was talking about running as a gerund. But in this case, fielding is a verbal noun as such. And this is a noun and therefore a gerund in that sense. A gerund is a verbal noun. So it basically acts as a noun, but the form of the word seems to be like a verb. Right? That is why we call it a verbal noun. But it is a noun that actually it exists. So the coach taught him what? The coach taught him fielding. The coach taught him how to field. Now, this also answers the question, the coach taught him what? But now you have how to field. And so therefore, it is a noun. It's an NT. You get the difference in the sense. Finite verb, action plus tense. And non-finite verbs could be infinitives or, you know, like planned or desired actions or doing ongoing action or clen, which is the completed action, right? So this is how you would be identifying them. In the exam, obviously, because it's a Google form, we are not expecting you to do all of this, which might be good for you because you don't have to remember those. You just have to remember how to identify them. Right? So I'm just giving these as examples. And it's almost time up. I don't want to exhaust ourselves too much more, but I do want to state certain things. 1 minute, let me check. I will be sharing with you the drive folder to a drive part that comes in. You know, what I will be doing for y'all is I am just going to share right now on the Google, on the Telegram group itself. What is this group called of yours? MA English SEM 1, right? So I'm just I don't know whether I can post. So I don't think I can post. So I'll ask Priya or Santosh Rathod to post, to allow me to post. But I will share this in case, in any case, what I will also do for y'all is right now in the chat, be posting these links. So maybe you can just copy paste from the chat and look at these video links. There is one thing that's called the playlist of videos, which was the older one that some of you were talking about. And there is a Google Drive folder that comes in as a folder link. And then there is a Blogspot that just also gives you the same information piece, but for the older syllabus. But you can be looking at any and all of this. Now, the reason for why I'm giving you this Google folder link is that the UOM, Linguistic and Stylistic Analysis, this PPT that I've been sharing, is within this folder. So what you have access to is this folder. And within the folder, there are these multiple PPTs. But what you have, this is the, this is the University of Mumbai Linguistic and Stylistic Analysis, almost the last one. That is the PPT that we have been looking at. So in case you want to have a closer look, the video doesn't give you a very good look and you want to zoom in and all of it, you have these available, right? So the folder link is view access. I think if you click on it, you should be able to get that. What you also have here is a question paper of 60 marks, which was the earlier question paper, which tells you about the kinds of questions that they were asking in the non-multiple choice question. But why do I want you to look at this is, I think I have given the sample answer to this question somewhere, if I'm not mistaken. So you can look at those kinds of questions and the sample answers that come in from those questions. So yeah, this one had a sample answer to the question of where they were. So you can practice, you can take these for practice. And then, try and solve them. And of course, the book also of yours gives you quite a few of the practice exercises. You can take from there as well. If you have any doubts from the book, please let me know. And I'm happy to help you solve and go through them to a large, to whatever extent. Yeah? Does this help? It's 8:03. I know some of you have dinner to prepare dinner and have dinner. So I just...
Yes, Priyanka? Can I share the link?
In the chat, I did, right, just now?
Oh, because I somehow got logged out, and so I don't have the link to the... I'm so sorry.
Should I just recheck the Zoom recording? I'm just copy-pasting the chat again. I mean, copy-pasting the links again. I hope that works.
Thank you so much.
Welcome. I will ask Priya to let me be posting on the Telegram because I like it on the Telegram because I can then pin the message and do that. But right now I don't have permission to do it. So I will ask them to do that. And then I will also upload on the playlist, the same playlist that I've given you and a separate playlist for semester one. I'll upload on both of them. Basically upload the video and add it to both of them as the video recording of today. Yeah. So that also you should have.
They do upload whatever lectures we are having online
But it is not on YouTube, which becomes very irritating because I'm like, I can't search all this. One of the reasons I said Zoom and I said I will record is because I was like, I will hold responsibility for this. I don't want a Google folder, one video at one time. So anyway, you will have access to all of this. There are some old videos also in that playlist. I mean, all those videos are older videos, but they are also on the same topics and they are all useful to look at and study. But I hope you got a sense of what the paper is, why the paper is, and what the paper can do. So what we have been looking at is question 2 and 3, which is 50% of your paper. And we will continue doing that on Wednesday. And then we will move into student-centric writing and short notes on Thursday, and then Friday we will have a revision in that sense. So I hope to be able to complete a lot of what your portion is supposed to be about in these 4 days. But otherwise, if we need more lectures, we can just see, because I'm not sure of what timings and others. And you have a lot more other lectures also to be organized.
And then from 18th, I think we start the MCQ, we start the exams.
Correct, which is why I'm trying to finish off and finish the portion as ASAP.
Yes.
Yeah?
Yeah.
So the others who have not been talking, I hope you got the points, and please do ask questions. Generally, try to keep it interactive. So do chat, do ask questions. Stop me at any time. But thank you all for sparing your evening, and have a good dinner ahead. I don't think.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you so much.
Great learning from you. Thank you so much.
All right. I'll end the call. I'll see you on Wednesday. Not tomorrow, but Wednesday.
Yeah.
Yes, ma'am. Thank you.
And please do practice and then come back on Wednesday.
Ma'am, one request on phrases and clauses, if you can take some more examples.
Yeah, so that is what we'll do on Wednesday, but you need also go through the material. Yeah. So one of the things that you can do, and I will suggest that you do, is in the folder. There is a folder. One second. Huh? Just bear with me for a minute. Share 1 second. In the folder, what you have is, since you were asking me this question, you have something that is called clause and phrase analysis, sentences 1. Okay, this is a PDF. But this tells you what these clauses are about. But more importantly, according to me, I have been very nice in, I praise myself a lot. So compound sentences, noun clauses, all types of noun clauses, relative clauses have all been organized here for you. So even if you go through this and try and solve it on your own and ask questions, we can work from there, right? So maybe you can just do this. This is called clause and phrase analysis, practice sentences 1. That's what this is called.
So you are sharing with us, ma'am, that on the
Google folder link jo maine share kiya usme ye hai.
Okay.
Right? So you can just go here and check it. There are some other clause analysis practice. There is a lot of clause analysis given, because everyone keeps saying we want more examples. But there's only so many examples I can give, which are, I mean, I'm quite tired in creating more and more examples. So I just say practice and we'll discuss doubts. But there are these examples given, so you can try and practicing from there. And you can look up, there is another one which I do, which is the clause and phrase analysis assignment. This is one of the very irritating ones, because this is what would have, you know, if you had exam, then this is the kind of question you would have got in the exam, in the sense of the written exam. Then you would have got a question on a passage and been told that analyze the clauses and analyze these phrases. So this is, again, this has been done for you, right? So this is another place where you can go in and read it up as examples. My suggestion is write it and try and solve it in your head and verify. And not everything is right here, because I was also doing it in a hurry, but it is all there. I have given you a link to a Blogspot, which also has the same thing, but the folder has a lot more of information. So you can actually look up the information here. Clauses, linguistic and stylistic analysis 4. This also has clauses in it. the middle, not at the beginning, but it has in the middle. Then there is phrases which are given. And then there are pointers for short notes that are given. But you also have these kinds of elements that are all working through. So, yeah, I don't. Yeah, and plus you have your textbook. So you can go through those. Yeah. So in sheet 2 or sheet 3, I think I gave more sentences at some point. And clauses also is there. So you can go through your textbook, the handout that is there, and the, you know, the syllabus that is there. This is the old syllabus, but I'll also put up the new syllabus. In case you don't have the new syllabus as a PDF, I'll put the new syllabus as well. Right? So all that becomes your text. Okay?
Right, ma'am. Thank you so much.
Most welcome. Now I
thank you, ma'am.
Better cook. So I'll take your leave. Bye.
See you. Yes, bye. Thank you.
Bye. Thank you. Bye-bye. Bye-bye.